Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
And we are here for the beautiful Feast of the Epiphany. We've been tracking the movement of the Magi throughout all of Advent into the Christmas season. And today is the day that the Magi finally make their way to the manger. So today we are celebrating their gifts at the manger. As some of you know, this has become a day for us to bring gifts to the manger in support of vulnerable families in our community. If you brought gifts of diapers or whatnot, I invite you to bring those with you to the back, and I invite everyone, if you are willing and able, to join us in the back of the church. We will form our procession there and come bearing our gifts and bearing ourselves as gifts to the manger. And I also want to say a special, special welcome to our bishop, Bishop Craig Loya, who is here with us. So excited that you are here to celebrate this feast day with us. And to Canon Blair Pope, our canon for vitality and innovation, who's here with us as well. So it's just a big, splendid, reverent, joyful, thankful day. And thank you for being here to offer your gifts of yourselves and other gifts as well. So again, welcome. And join us in the back, please.
Ha ha ha! To us a child is born, O come, let us adore him. Blessed be the one holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together, they come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on the nurse's arms. Then you shall see and be radiant, your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you, the wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense, and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
reason that I, Paul, am a prisoner for Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. For surely you have already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I wrote above in a few words, a reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. In former generations, this mystery was not made known to humankind, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers in the promise of Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of his power. Although I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of the boundless riches of Christ, and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church the wisdom of God and its rich variety might now be made known to the real rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born the King of the Jews? For we observed his star in its rising, and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophets, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means last among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go out and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there, ahead of them, went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thanks for sharing her with us in the office.
This is an extraordinary congregation. You all are a model of what it means to be a vital, faithful group of Jesus' disciples. And I want you to know, even though I'm not here all that often, you make me proud to be the Bishop of Minnesota. So thanks for who you are and for what you do in this place. When I was about 13 years old, I was hiking in the Rocky Mountains in Colorado with my family and a few friends. And that was a pretty common thing when I was a kid. I grew up in western Nebraska. I know you can tell because of like the glow of holiness that surrounds me. I grew up in western Nebraska, which means that the Rocky Mountains were kind of like our backyard. It's where we went all the time. And one time when I was about 13 years old, I was hiking with my family and a few friends. And we came to a place in the trail where there was a little clearing and kind of some more space, and we just sort of used that to take a little break. And while we were all taking a break, I kind of wandered off just a little ways by myself to take in one of those really magnificent mountain views where you can see pine and snow-capped peaks rolling on for what seems like forever. And as I sat there, taking in that view for just a few minutes, all of a sudden, it was as if I was completely alone, even though my family was probably only 15 yards away. And I got this overwhelming sense of being a tiny little speck in the midst of something that is vast and big. I had a sense that in a very real way in that moment, I was being held. And I was overwhelmed with the certainty that I was looking at God face to face. It was a moment of absolute clarity and certainty for me of God's immediate reality and presence. And all these years later, that moment continues to be one of the touchstones of my faith and how I experience God. And I grew up, you know, the church was not, you know, some people go to church on Christmas and Easter. We would sort of go on Christmas or Easter. So it was around in my childhood, but it wasn't a big part of how we understood ourselves. So one of the things that shocked me about that moment is it's not like I was looking for it. I wasn't out there thinking about God or trying to find or experience God. But in a very real and unexpected way, it found me in that moment. And that's always stayed with me. Today, if you haven't noticed, we are celebrating the Feast of the Epiphany. And the word epiphany in Greek simply means an intense appearing. And so the Feast of the Epiphany, among other things, reminds us of what I learned that day on that mountain in Colorado. It reminds us that God is always pursuing us. The Feast of the Epiphany reminds us that God is always looking for us. God is always seeking us out, longing to embrace us and to be in relationship with us. If you read through the Bible, you will find that the God who is revealed in the Bible is not an abstract idea. The God who is revealed in the Bible is not some philosophical principle. The God we meet in the Bible is a God who's on the move, who's always hunting for us, who's always trying to find us and to draw us in closer. Christmas, that all starts at Christmas, which we celebrated a few weeks ago. Christmas is how God moves into the neighborhood to be among us. An epiphany, where a bunch of wise men see a star in the sky and they think it's big enough that they got to get in the car immediately and drive to see what's going on. If Christmas is God moving into the neighborhood in Jesus, then Epiphany is God blowing up the boundaries of what counts as a neighborhood. So that God doesn't just move into one neighborhood in ancient Palestine with one group of people at one point in history. Epiphany reminds us that God is moving into every neighborhood, into every culture, into every people, every family, and every heart. I mean, a story we know really well, right? So you miss how kind of nuts it is. The wise men who came from the east really had no interest in or no business with what the God of Israel happened to be up to, right? The wise men are foreigners. They're outsiders. They don't obviously belong in the conversation that's happening there in the manger in Bethlehem. So the gospel lesson that we heard this morning reminds us that God pursues us with a love that will not be deterred by the barriers of nationality or ethnicity or religion or race or any of the other ways that we construct things to keep some people out. God's always on the move, making every neighborhood into God's neighborhood. And while it's true that God is pursuing us and trying to find us whether we know it or not, I should be quick to add it. Like, it doesn't hurt when we're looking for God, right? That's not a bad thing when we're on the lookout for God. And what I've come to understand in all those years since I had that moment in Colorado is that that's what faith is about. That's what all of this that we're doing this morning is about. The Christian faith is not so much about a bunch of things that we believe to be true with our brains. The Christian faith, more than anything else, is about living with a posture of openness. It's about learning how to watch for those epiphanies, those intense appearings that God is always using in our lives and in the world around us to seek us out and find us. That's what this morning's about, right? That's why we gather and do this week by week. It's teaching us, forming us, shaping us to be watchful for what God is doing. That's why we commit to daily practices of prayer, of being with God. It's a way of training our eyes, cultivating a sense of watchfulness for the God who is always on the move, trying to seek us out and embrace us. And that's a good thing, at least I hope you think that's a good thing. But here's the deal. The reason why God is always seeking us out, the reason why God is always trying to embrace us and draw us closer, is not just so we can have a series of kind of warm and fuzzy experiences on our family vacations. The reason why God is seeking us out and hunting us down and drawing us closer is so that we can be part of God's project of building an entirely new world order. I don't know if you noticed, but that gospel lesson this morning makes a really big point of drawing a sharp contrast between two kings in the gospel lesson. On the one hand, you have King Herod. And on the other hand, you have the new king, King Jesus. And King Herod, like most of the worldly powers and rulers that have ever existed, rules by anxiously trying to cling to what he already has, who sees others as a threat to his supremacy, and when he perceives that threat, responds with a horrifying and murderous violence. King Jesus, on the other hand, who is the real king, these three, when they go to Herod, snub him big time, walk right by him. He's not the one they're looking for. As opposed to King Herod, who rules with violence from the halls of power, King Jesus shows up here in a feeding bucket for animals, watched over by two poor, terrified young parents in the absolute middle of nowhere. King Jesus is given myrrh as a way of showing the point of King Jesus is to die. King Jesus rules not by clinging tightly to power and responding to threats with murderous violence. King Jesus rules by giving himself away fully over in love. So the epiphanies that God is always longing to show us in our lives are for drawing us into that new movement, to draw us into God's project of healing and saving a whole murderously mad world with endless love and peace. So there's two questions for us this morning. The first one is, can you learn to see the way that God is always reaching out to you? Can you learn to recognize the ways that God is always pursuing you, longing to draw you in closer and to embrace you? And the second question, can all of us together commit every single moment of the rest of our lives to pledging our allegiance to King Jesus? Can you, in your own life, in the life of your family, at St. David's Church, can all of us together commit every moment of the rest of our lives to joining God's project to completely flip the world upside down with love? Until the whole world becomes an endless epiphany of love, of justice, of joy, of peace without end. Amen. Do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil and renew your commitment to Jesus Christ?
I do.
Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord.
I will with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will with God's help.
May Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us a new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed upon us the forgiveness of sins, keep us in eternal life by his grace. In Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
Be seated. I believe this is the time when we do birthday and anniversary prayers. So are there folks who have birthdays or anniversaries during the month of January? Join me in saying the birthday prayer. O God, our times are in your hands. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Prayer for anniversaries.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, sovereign of the universe, who in your steadfast love made a covenant with your people Israel, and consummated it through the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Let these servants' covenant promises be a sign of your mercy, forgiveness, and ardent desire, that through their common life you may bind up the brokenhearted and reconcile all things in heaven and earth. In the power of your life-giving spirit. Amen.
Happy birthday and happy anniversary.
give thanks for the holiness of your creation. Help us rejoice with our whole heart and soul and voice.
Good morning.
Put all things in subjection. bring us to that heavenly country where with David and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Steve and Jim are taking communion this morning to Jenny and Kathy Johnson. In the name of this congregation, I send you forth, bearing these holy gifts, that those who you go may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood.
We who are many are one body, because we share the one bread and the one cup.
Let us pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for restoring us in your image and nourishing us with the spiritual food in the sacrament of Christ's body and blood. Now send us forth as a people, forgiven, healed, renewed, that we may proclaim your love to the world and continue in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. Now, beloved, go in safety. For you cannot go where God is not. Go in love, for love alone endures. Go in peace, for that is God's gift to those whose hearts and minds are in God's Son, Jesus. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with each of you forever. Amen. Amen.
Joins us downstairs in the undercroft. So, children and youth, if you want. want to get ready to process out with Anna and the bishop right after the dismissal, that'd be great. Other announcements? Well, not Bonnie.
I do want to say that after a holiday break, we're going to be back for youth group on Wednesday night. We'll be at Trinity. So that'll be 6:30 to 8:30 for grades 6 and 12. And also, yes, children and youth. So that means littlest all the way through high school. I want you to come join us in the Badley Playroom, and we're going to have a little Q&A with the bishop. We'll have 15 minutes with him. So bring your questions. Please follow us down there. We'll get cookies and treats after. There will still be some there. Yeah. So follow me down. Follow the cross down, and we will have some time with the bishop.
Hi, Bobby Zonkin-Dilla here. So Marcus and I are hosts downstairs today after he comes back with the bishop. But, okay, I don't. So we brought a Roscoe Samarias cake, which is a Mexican cake from a bakery in Minneapolis, which is a tradition within the Mexican culture where they bring this cake. And you'll see it's the shape of a wreath, and it's always free-picking. So within the cake, there are 7 baby Jesuses to help us carry Jesus forward as we go forward into this path. We're also having Mexican hot chocolate today, so hope everyone really enjoys the snacks downstairs and just thinks about the other cultures that we bring along with us as well.
I just want to thank the band. So the first time that Larry Newman came, I told you we had gotten in a lot of liturgical trouble before, and this is what I meant. Larry Newman on sax, and Keith Dallas on bass, and Peter Hanley on drums, and the drum choir.
Concert on Sunday, January 22nd, 3 p.m. right here, and I'm happy to say that Roger's going to be joining us. We're shaking it up a bit, doing solos, duets, trios, and we're really excited to work with Roger, so make sure you check it out Sunday at 3 on the 22nd.
Lord, for the altar guild, and I want to thank everyone who donated to the Christmas flowers. And those of you who did and others may take the flowers after the service today so that they can get a new home. Thank you.
Pammy Jerkovich. I'm here to tell you that in addition to our amazing rock and roll deacon, and he has band, as many of you know, and they're going to be performing this, this month on January 25th and 26th at the 318 Cafe, and he's going to have Paul Pedersen with him as part of his band, and he's going to have Peter Hewley as part of his band as well. So the performance is at the 318 Cafe in Excelsior. It's on January 25th, and there's another one on 26th, and it's from 8 to 10, and I hope to see you there. I'll be there both nights. Thanks.
I invite you to stand for this dismissal.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Go in peace, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Hallelujah.